Good morning. My name's Chance Armstrong. I'm a large animal clinician at the LSU School for Veterinary Medicine. And today we're going to be talking about the bull breeding soundness evaluation. Wish we all could be together today, but we're going to try to make this virtual experience good for you and explain why this is such an important part of your program. Every bull should be checked every year before the breeding season, approximately 45 to 60 days prior to turning him out. You're asking yourself, why that 45 to 60 days? What's magical about that? Well, it gives us a close enough exam to the actual turnout time so he doesn't change that much. And also it gives us enough time if there's something that we can change from a veterinary perspective, or if the bull is deemed to be unsatisfactory and we find that he may not return to fertility, that we have time enough to replace him in the bull battery. So that's what we're going to be doing today. I want to talk to you about the four parts of the exam. The first part being the physical, that starts as the bull moves through the pens. He has to be able to mount and breed cows, and so he has to be able to move around, evaluate those cows in heat, so he must be able to find those cows. So we want to see if he's bouncing off of everything. Is he visual, okay? And also, can he travel? So that's where the first part of the exam starts, is the physical, and that's the biggest part of the exam. We need to make sure that his reproductive apparatus, he can actually complete the breeding act. So we're going to evaluate his penis, his prepuce, his scrotum, or his sperm making factory. We're going to evaluate that as well by palpating the scrotum and the testicles to make sure that there's no abnormalities there. And then we're going to do an internal exam evaluating his accessory sex glands on the rectum exam before we actually collect this bull and look at his semen. As we've all known for a long time, scrotal circumference is very important. We want to select for larger scrotal circumference bulls because their daughters are going to have an inverse relationship. The bigger the scrotal circumference, the earlier those daughters come into production or come into puberty. And so that's a value added to the operation for sure. And so the bigger the better. And so when you're comparing two bulls, we're going to do a scrotal circumference measurement. That's the second part at the widest most part of the scrotum. Bulls have to be a minimum of 30 centimeters in width by 15 months of age, okay? By 2 years of age, they have to be a minimum of 34 centimeters to make the minimums set forth by the breeding soundness evaluation guidelines through Society for Theriogenology, which is our governing body in veterinary medicine that sets the guidelines based on the literature, okay? And that just means he's got a big enough factory to achieve those goals that we set forth for him, that's designed, this exam is designed to evaluate. What are those goals? The goals are he should breed 60% of his allotted females in the first 21 days of the breeding season, okay? At the end of the breeding season, he should have greater than 90% of those cows covered if their cycling and their reproductive health is sound. So if he's doing his job, those are the benchmarks that we set for him, and why this exam is so important for every producer to put in part as a part of their normal herd health protocol. To prove to you a little bit why you should be doing this exam. If you look at the economics of it, with no calves born, we're not going to have a sustainable operation. We've looked into the literature and put a pencil on it, and for every dollar you invest in this, there's a $7 return to the producer. So it's a good return on your investment. If you think about it, what could be lost with a subfertile bull that's running around in your place out with your cows? Every 21 days that he misses that cow, meaning she cycled, and because of something that was a problem with him and his fertility, he may be subfertile, he's not efficient breeder, you're going to lose about 50 pounds of weaning weight. That's just something as an industry we cannot give away. And so we want these guys to be efficient breeders. And that's really the justification behind this exam. Okay, we're going to move into the first part of the exam here, which is the physical part. We're going to actually get the bull in the chute. It's very important that you don't get these two bulls riled up coming into the chute because they tend not to collect as well. And so we try to move them in here with low stress kettle handling techniques as best we can. And those bulls will tend to collect a lot better for your veterinarian as you move them into the chute system. I also am evaluating if he's visual. If he's bouncing off all parts of our chute system, he's probably got something going on there. I want to look into that a little deeper. I also want to evaluate his body condition score. I always tell the students I work with that sex is a luxury to a cow, and what I mean by that, reproduction is going to pay the toll first if he's not in a good body condition. All right, so we've got to have adequate energy to partition towards reproduction. I want these guys to look like well-defined athletes, like Olympic athletes going into the breeding season. So a 6 or 7 body condition, I don't want them over-conditioned. That can lead to joint problems. That also can lead to semen quality issues because just like us, we don't get to choose where we throw down fat. The bull does not either. Sometimes he will throw down fat in the neck of the scrotum, which will insulate those testicles, leading to semen quality issues. And so we don't want them overly conditioned. Definitely don't want them under condition. Again, we're going to shoot for a 6 to 7 out of 9 on a beef scale as far as our body condition score. And you have all year to kind of get him conditioned that way to be a fine muscled athlete going in there, because we know if he's doing his job, he's going to lose about 2 body conditions out there with the cows doing his job, working those 60 to 70 days during a controlled breeding season. So we're going to get him in here right now. I'm going to look at him and then we'll start the rest of our physical exam. Looking at his testicles and also his penis and prepuce. Got this Hereford bull in here. One more thing I want to point out to you that we need to do is we need to get a positive ID on this bull. So I can put it on my form, correctly identify these animals so that the producer, especially in multi-bull batteries, know what these animals are doing before they decide to market this animal. If he does not, if he's not satisfactory, we'll clip his hairs here around the prepuce to make sure we get a clean sample that we can evaluate more readily. While I'm down here, I usually go ahead and do my exam on the scrotum. You see that he's got his leg back, it's nice here. They should be symmetrical, and they should palpate like a half-flexed forearm. I'm palpating for anything in the neck of the scrotum, like fat. He does not have any of that. Those testicles, or those scrotums, tend to look like a very blocky in appearance. His does not. You see it comes down and tapers down there, which it should be. I'm palpating the epididymis, which is his final maturation point for his semen as it exits the testicles, making sure there's no abnormalities. These testicles should be freely movable, and his are completely normal. Now, we're going to get a scrotal circumference while we're down here, so I'm going to force these testicles down, and I'm going to measure here at the widest most point, okay? Indent the skin. He's a 36 and a half, okay? That's I don't know how old he is. We got to find out from the producer how old he is for our sheet. And so I think he meets the, how old is he?
17 months.
He's 17 months, so that's more than adequate. 17 months of age, he meets the minimum. At the same time, I'm looking at his feet, making sure there's no abnormalities of his feet, such as interdigital fibromas. Maybe there's some evidence of laminitis there that would preclude him from traveling. Again, the rest of the exam doesn't matter very much if he cannot walk, okay? So he has to be able to walk and travel and serve cows in a natural setting. And so we want to make sure and pay attention to that. The rest of the exam, if he fails on the physical if he is actually lame. Now that's something that we may be able to do something about from a veterinary standpoint, but it's something we critically evaluate when the bull's in the chute. He's off the ground in this chute here, and we can evaluate all 4 of his legs, the distal limbs, making sure there's no swellings there. I'm also looking down here and making sure that I don't see any big swellings here in the prepuce. We're gonna get him extended here in just a minute. I'm looking at this bull. He's probably in about a 6 body condition score. That is subjective, but I put him in a 6. He's in adequate enough body condition to go out with cows, all right? At this point, we're gonna change over, and I'm gonna put on a sleeve and I'm going to palpate his accessory sex glands and prepare him for electroejaculation. Try to stimulate these bulls too before we put the probe in. They'll collect a lot easier for us if we do a good job of stimulating them manually. I'm palpating for any type of infection in here in the sex or sex glands, which we see most commonly in young bulls that have been on a development type ration. And so we want to make sure that that is not a problem for these animals. We can palpate that. We also can see that when we get to the working under the microscope when we actually collect this bull. So I'm stimulating him. I spend a little bit more time fatiguing his rectum and stimulating these young bulls so they'll collect at the lowest power and also the quickest. Okay, that's my goal, is to get a sample I can evaluate in the most efficient manner on these guys without causing too much stress. We found that through the literature, this is not a painful procedure, but this is a stressful procedure, but also just putting an animal in the chute is considered stressful, okay? I'm gonna put our probe in, see if we can get a sample on him, and finish the other two parts, which would be the work under the microscope. So we've got a collection device here. I've also got just a piece of gauze to really hold the penis in extension so I get a clean sample. Anything above 40 degrees, I want to control the temperature on this sample from the time it ejects the penis to the time that we look at it under the scope. So we do protect it. The styrofoam coffee cup works great in anything greater than 40 degrees. You see down here, we'll put a water bath down here and put a collection device in here if it's less than 40 degrees outside. And sometimes we see that in Louisiana, but it's not terribly common. I'm looking for extension of this penis. He's starting to extend now. You see his prepuce here. Here's the free portion of his penis. And this is mostly prostatic fluid we don't want to catch. He's getting a good erection here, and I'm looking at it, making sure there's no abnormalities of the prepuce or penis. He can get full extension. It's very important that we visualize this penis on young bulls, on every bull, but particularly on young bulls that can have some congenital abnormalities that we don't want to miss out on. He's starting to get a little opaque here. I got a little sample in here. Again, this styrofoam cup insulates it until I make my two slides. Again, we're gonna look for two things under the microscope, would be for motility and then morphology. I tell the students I get to work with, if you look under this scope, anybody can buy one of these microscopes and look under there and see something moving. And I tell them, you know, you got a better education at LSU. If you look under there and you say he's a good bull, if you see something moving under that scope, the next thing out of your mouth should be Roll Tide, because that's about as good as your education is, okay? So it's better than that. We got to look deeper into that and see how these cells are shaped. We're doing nothing for the producer by passing a bull that is subfertile. And so we want to make sure we do a complete exam on these bulls. And so I'm going to go ahead and make a slide here, and we're going to stain it, okay? We're going to stain it. We're going to kill these cells and see how they're shaped by using some live dead stain here, some eosinigrosin stain. And we'll make a couple of slides and then we'll dry them very quickly. For my veterinary friends out there, this is sort of like making a blood smear. And I always make two slides in case I didn't do good on the first one. Next, we're gonna go to the motility. He must be 30% motile. So 30% of his cells must be swimming in a forward linear direction. As we evaluate this bull, I'm gonna put a neat drop of semen or just a raw drop of semen up here and look at it under the scope. See if we got a live sample, and we do. Okay, he ejaculated, which is great. Now we go one step further, and I'm gonna actually dilute this out with some warm saline to see how those individual cells are swimming. They should be moving in a forward linear direction. We put this under a cover slip, and then we evaluate it under the scope. Again, I'm looking for these cells to be swimming in a forward linear direction. And they are. So these are about 60% motile. Again, the minimum is 30% on this, so this bull passes this part of the exam. So far, he's passed all the parts of the exam. Scrotal circumference, his physical looks good, and also his motility is adequate. Now, we go to the morphology. This is how the cells are shaped. Again, you should be demanding this of your veterinarian, that they perform this part, because what we find in the literature, that far and away over the last 30 years, across all hospitals in the United States, that this is the reason bulls are deemed unsatisfactory and deferred most commonly, okay? So you wanna do this, and look how they're shaped. Just because they're swimming doesn't mean they can achieve a pregnancy, and again, we can't afford that in our industry. It's just simply something we have to avoid, is those bulls running around in the pasture that are subfertile. When I say subfertile, that may not mean something to you. So what is it really defined as, subfertile? It doesn't mean he can't get any cows pregnant. It means he's not gonna be an efficient breeder, okay? So a cow that's cycling, he goes and he breeds her and he misses her because of poor semen quality, okay? So we're gonna look at this on oil. So I put a little oil there. We're gonna pull it into the scope here. And then we're gonna count 100 cells. So we're gonna move this around. I've got a counter here. We're gonna count 100 cells, okay? And so what we're looking for is normal head abnormalities, midpiece abnormalities, and then tail abnormalities, okay? The head and the midpiece are more significant abnormalities, telling me there's probably a problem inside the testicle. Tail abnormalities are more of a storage problem historically. And so we'll be able to evaluate and be able to prognosticate whether this bull is gonna return to breeding soundness, depending on his age. Really, a young bull and a mature bull, BSC, are two different exams to me. A lot of times we see some things that these young bulls, particularly as young as he is, he may be still peripubertal. I haven't seen anything to make me believe that, but that is very commonly to see as a part of a yearling bull examination. Move around to different parts of the slide so we can see different parts and make sure we evaluate this. If I have a bull that's marginal, I'll count 300 cells, but normally we just count 100 unless he's a marginal bull. Bull's 86% normal. We got 4% head abnormality, 7 on the midpiece, and 3 tails. He meets the minimum of 70% of his cells must be normal to pass the breeding soundness evaluation. So one last thing I'll do, I'm gonna write all this information down on our form here. This is the Society's for Theriogenology's form. Other people make their own form, it's fine. It's just we want to evaluate all four parts. That's the complete BSC, and that's what we should be offering you as producers. Talk with your veterinarian about what this exam means to you and how you can incorporate that into a sound herd health protocol on your operation. I promise you it'll be something that will help you be sustainable in this industry for a long time. Thank you very much.